Welcome, welcome. Thank you to the public for being here. Hello, we have all members of the council present. My name's Kat Martinez and I will be leading the meeting today. So I'm going to call this meeting to order and we will start off with the Pledge of Allegiance, which our new Miss Murray Morgan Workman has agreed to lead us in. So she'll come on up and lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Please stand.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, and with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you so much. All right, next up, we're going to move on to the minutes. We have minutes from council meeting September 21st, 2021, and council meeting October 5th, 2021. Are there any corrections or concerns?
Nope. Would you like a motion?
I would.
Can I take them together?
Yes, please.
All right. I would move approval of the minutes for council meeting September 21st, 2021, and council meeting October 5th, 2021.
I'll second that.
Thank you. Brooke?
Mr. Cox?
Aye.
Mr. Aye.
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 Aye. Thank you. All right. Next up, we're moving on to special recognition. To start out, we have Murray City Council Employee of the Month, Kay Astle, Office Administrator, too. And we've got Brett Hales and Danny Astle presenting.
Come on up, Kay. Now, Kay Astle, Danny Astle, is there any relation here?
No.
No. Well, by marriage, there is. Yeah. Kay, come on up. So this is Kay Astle, and Kay is much younger than me, but we grew up together. Look at her laugh. Anyway, we grew up together in Magna, and she has been a staple here at Murray City. You've been here 25 years? 25 years. That needs a round of applause right now. So, Kay, have you always been in public works or the whole time?
Yep.
So, Danny, how long have you been here, Danny? Well, I was going to say other way around, he got the job because of you, but anyway, Kay is a wonderful person, always greets you with a smile, always polite, and we are grateful to be able to have this Employee of the Month recognition by the council. It's a great program that we started several years ago, and I've had the honor to be able to, it's one of the things that was important to me to be able to recognize our employees. And so without further ado, Kay and her husband, Kevin, is here. And Kevin, he's a lot older than us, isn't he? Look, he looks young, but don't let that fool you. But okay, so there's your certificate. Absolutely. And then we'll put your name back on the plaque here. And then this is the recognition. And then Danny's going to have a few things to say. But the most important thing we have you is a $50 gift card for you. So, Kay, thank you for all you do. We appreciate you. Thank you. All right. Thank you, guys. Okay. Now we'll turn the time over to Danny.
Well, I'm going to tell the story. You're not going to tell. Are you going to tell the story?
So, Danny's wife is Kay's sister. They married, and Danny's, oh, man, I'm not going to have a hard time doing this, but
Kay's
sister is married to Danny's brother.
No.
Okay. Holy cow. I could. They're two sisters married two brothers. That's all.
Thanks, Brett. You got that one right. Thank you, Council and Mayor, for the time this evening and recognizing Kay. Like Brett said, she's worked for Public Works for just a little over 25 years, actually. And she's been plays a very significant role in public works. There's only two office people, and she's one of the first faces that any public sees when they come into the office, into public works. And so we it's a good face for them to see. I'll just tell you that. If they saw the rest of us, they probably would walk out. She's just really exceptionally nice to everybody that she encounters, and we're grateful for that. But she comes into the office happy every day. She's got a smile on her face. She brings this amazing positive attitude, and I know that she's not all the time, because I know her personally. But she brings that to work, and that is a great thing to have. And she brings that into her work, and that's really good. But she assists the office supervisor in a number of critical tasks for public works, and especially in helping the public understand and get them the help that they need. As public works, we do a lot of things. So she generally works basically 4 hours a day, so from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. And in that, she even makes a run to City Hall to pick up correspondence that's going back and forth from City Hall to Public Works. So there's a lot of things, and not just for us, but also for the CED downstairs for right now until we get a new City Hall. But anyway, with that, she's a dedicated employee. She's really flexible. And in fact, this last year, we all know that what we've been dealing with, but we've had some additional issues with medical, unexpected medical things that have taken place within our office. And she's worked weeks instead of part-time, full-time, as a full-time employee, basically. And so we have to be careful with her hours, because she is a permanent part-time, but we still can't go over a certain number of hours. So we're kind of careful with that. But she is so flexible. I'm very grateful that she's able to do that for us and to meet those needs, so that when we have that continuity within the office to help our public. And also to do our billing, because she does all of that as well as part of her responsibilities. But we want to make sure that our citizens are taken care of, and that's what she does. But she also takes care of all of the public works employees that come in and need things as well. So there's a lot that she does in that few hours that she's with us. We're fortunate that she came to Murray City that 25 years ago. She's a valued member of our team, and we're grateful for all the work that she does for the Murray community. But also, we just appreciate the opportunity to recognize that in Kay. So with that, I'd like to ask you to another round of applause for her. Introduce your husband.
My brother.
Okay. Kevin's a brother to you. Kevin, stand up. This is my husband. He's number 5 of 8 children, and Danny's number 6. Thanks, everybody.
Would anyone like to say anything?
No. Just a big thanks.
Yeah, same here.
Thank you for your commitment to Murray for so long.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
And if you'd like, you're welcome to stay for the whole meeting, or you're welcome to leave as well if you'd like to sneak out
Kevin
the side.
Kevin won't judge you quick.
At all. we won't look. It's fine.
Thank you.
All right, wonderful. Next up, I am so excited to announce this. Because I got to spend a little extra time with our 2021 Miss Murray, Kylie Cooper, this last year. So she's going to do her report and welcome 2022 Miss Murray, Morgan Workman, who we're very excited to meet. So Mayor Camp.
Thank you very much.
The Miss Murray Scholarship Competition was held on September 11th at Murray High School, in which Morgan Workman was named our new Miss Murray for 2022. And we'll hear from Morgan in a few minutes. You just got to see her in action already. So, yeah. And you may have seen her in action, too, last week at the park, at the public power, and so forth. But we'll hear from her in a few minutes. The competition on September 11th brought to an end a very busy and productive term for Kylie. And she's been an amazing ambassador for Murray City this year. We're fortunate to have her here this evening to give us an overview and her perspective on her year of service as Miss Murray. So I'd like to have Kylie come up, and while she's coming up, let me just mention that she will give her report, and then if you'll stay up here for just a minute, Kylie, I have a short presentation too. So.
Sure thing. All right. It is so good to be here in person this evening, because last year I had to Zoom in and it was just a very different time of life. And so it feels good to be in person. And I'll try and keep it together. I was a little emotional as Mayor Camp started talking, because this has been one of the best years of my life. But to start off, I've created a little video for everyone that kind of shows an overview of most of what I was able to do this year. So hopefully it works. Thank you.
show this one, huh? Almost there. There we go. Okay. Maybe. It's coming. There we are. All right. So I just kind of wanted to share with everyone tonight three of the things that I'm most grateful for, like learning as my year as Miss Murray. And that first one is just being so grateful for that Murray connection. I'm a Murray girl, always will be. Both of my parents are from Murray. I grew up here. We are a family that bleeds black and orange. And I loved that no matter where I went, most of the time I was able to find someone that knew someone from Murray, that was from Murray themselves, or had some memory of being in Murray. And I loved being able to share my love of Murray with not only Murray citizens, but those around the state as well. And one of the special experiences that I had this year was around this time last year, I was at the Mascot Miracles Parade, and this is the picture on the far left. And I was just passing out candy to children and young adults that are dealing with cancer and disabilities. And this little boy right here is a Murray boy. His name is Dustin, and he's 2 years younger than me. He's 23, and we went to school together. And I was able to recognize him through the masks, and that just made his day. He was so excited. He's deaf and deals with some other disabilities, but to be able to make that connection with him and make his evening and just see the big smile that showed up on his face was a very special experience for me. And I also loved being able to work with so many people in Murray. Like Kat Martinez said, we were able to do some things together this year, and I was able to shadow her in the creation of the Diversity and Inclusion Task Force. Learning from people from the Murray Chamber of Commerce will always be some very special experiences for me. And the second thing that I'm the most grateful for was one of my favorite things, was being able to share what I love with the people of Murray in ways that I maybe wouldn't have been able to otherwise. I grew up dancing, and at Brigham Young University, I was involved in their folk dance program. And one of my favorite styles of dance was Bollywood. And that is what I decided to do for my talent as Miss Murray. And I kept that talent, competed with it at Miss Utah, and was able to share it in many ways throughout this year. I was able to go on Good Things Utah, which is that bottom left picture right there, and share about my initiative, which is promoting unity over division, and do my talent performance as well. And I was also able to volunteer at many dance shows, helping judge dance co-tryouts. And these groups right here are all groups that I taught Bollywood choreography to. And so it was just a very special experience for me to be able to share what I love and something that is so important to me, because I love learning about other cultures. And that's how I connect with them, is through dance. And being able to share that with these students was very special, because it was something so new to them. And now they know something about Indian culture. And I hope that that is something that they'll always remember as they grow up. And then the third thing is just the countless opportunities to serve. Being able to speak to youth groups, to volunteer at the Murray Children's Pantry and see what that's all about. Collecting shoes. We were able to collect 1,580 pairs of shoes for the Souls of Souls organization. And those shoes will be donated to families that need shoes in third world countries. Being able to partner with the Murray Rotary Club, make that new connection with them. And we created a citywide cleanup service day where we were able to gather 90 volunteers. And we, I think it was about 190 55-gallon trash bags worth of trash that we picked up in Murray City. And we were so proud of that. And it was such a fun day for everyone to come out and come together. It was even a little rainy, you know, and so people still got out of bed and came out and joined us. And that was a fun experience. Being able to visit with people at the senior center, go into some of the schools and meet the young students, dress up as Jasmine and create some smiles on some children's faces around the holiday season, and also be involved with city events like putting the pinwheels outside of City Hall, passing out cards at the senior center, being involved with the arts at the park. Just so many different ways that I was able to not only get to know people, but have that opportunity to volunteer in ways that I wouldn't have been able to otherwise. So overall, the thing that I learned with my initiative, which is promoting unity over division, which is something I think that our world is desperately striving for right now at this time. And it was so vital when I won that I was like, this is like the perfect initiative to have right now with what's going on in the world. But what I took away from my year were those three things, that if we really do want to figure out how to promote unity instead of focusing so much on the division, is that we need to find that connection with community, that connection with other people. We need to share what we love with others and be willing to embrace other cultures and to accept each other's differences. And we need to find those ways to serve and to volunteer, because that's when our hearts are opened and our hearts can be changed. And so through those three things, I felt like I was able to kind of create that unifying spirit, not only for myself, but hopefully for some Murray citizens during my year as Miss Murray. And I hope that I'll continue to do that in my life, and that those that I touched will embrace that unifying spirit so that we continue to work towards striving to be a more unified city, state, nation, and world. And so I am very grateful for the opportunity that I had to serve my favorite city in the entire world and to represent Murray across my heart for a full year. And that is something that will stay with me for the rest of my life. So thank you so much.
So you can see by the slideshow, we got our money's worth out of Miss Murray this year. We can't pay these young women because we couldn't afford to. But no, what a wonderful year she's had. And as I was watching the slides, I remembered that last year our competition was held at the amphitheater because we were in the middle of the COVID outbreak, and we're unable to use the school, and we were all masked, and it was quite an event. So the reason I bring that up is that it was, as we kind of move forward from that isolation, is when Kylie was able to step forward and really do a great job. So thank you very much. As you see, she's been such a great ambassador to the city, as I mentioned earlier, and I'd like to present you with the Mayor's Award of Excellence for your excellent service. So thank you
so much.
Thank you. Before I invite Morgan to come up, I want to just take a second. I didn't get her permission because she would have said no, but back here is Lisa Lloyd, and Lisa holds a special place in my heart because she taught my girls to dance. But oh, and by the way, I had a daughter that danced with Kylie too. But so anyway, Lisa's been here year after year after year after year, supporting this this competition and these young women. So thank you, Lisa. So I'd now like to invite Morgan Workman to come forward and introduce herself to the council and to the public, and to Morgan, explain what your social impact initiative is.
Oh.
While they're getting that set up, just another comment. When we were at the talent competition this year, made a brief presentation to Kylie, and then went backstage and was talking with one of the one of the mothers and one of the those who help with this competition every year, and she said to me, she said, first of all, she said, Mayor, thank you for your support of the competition, and she said, we do our best every year to get you the best young women possible. And I said, I know you do, and this is an example of some of the best of the best. So
And please don't feel bad. This happens to department heads every single time. So it's not just you. I don't want you to feel like it's just you.
All right. Okay. So I am Morgan Workman, Miss Murray 2022. I'm so excited for my year, and I'm so excited to just be able to connect with all of you and meet you and experience new things. So, a little bit about me is I grew up in Murray. I graduated from Murray High School in 2020. Not the best year, but we made the best of it, right? We're gonna remember 2020 forever, and that's okay. I'm currently attending the University of Utah. I am planning on majoring in entrepreneurship and am going to minor in modern dance. I have danced my whole entire life. I actually, one of my favorite experiences was dancing with Odyssey Dance Theater. I was able to dance with them for a whole entire season, and I performed with them in Thriller. I don't know if any of you guys have seen that, the iconic Thriller at Kingsbury Hall, right? I got to play a zombie. It was the best experience ever. I'm like, ah! I hope to soon establish my scholarship program that I'll talk to you a little bit more about soon. As a 501c3 nonprofit, that's my goal, and make it a full-time job. So my social impact initiative is the Gift of Movement Scholarship. The Gift of Movement Scholarship is a scholarship for youth 18 years and under who can't afford to do sports or performing arts extracurricular activities. Growing up, I experienced the feeling of not being able to afford dance. And so that's where I found this scholarship, and I really wanted to bring it to youth lives. And I can't wait to do that, to continue doing that this year. I actually, before winning Miss Murray, I had the opportunity to do a fundraising event, a self-defense class, where we raised actually $1,000, and I was able to give it to a little girl named Gracie. And she is going to definitely use it the best, because she can't afford to dance. And I was in that position when I was young. And so I am so excited that she gets to use that. And I want to keep doing that for kids all over Murray City this year. That's my goal. One of my plans is to hold a 5K on April 9th. I actually got this approved not that long ago. So I'm excited to hold that. And if you follow the MissMurray.Utah account, you'll be able to get updates on that. So I would love to have you guys there if you can make it. So since I won on September 11th, I have done a lot of stuff. It has been so cool to get involved with the city and meet people, and it's the opportunity of a lifetime, and I'm so, so grateful that I get to do this. A few of the things up there are, I attended Spartan Spec for Murray High School. I was able to attend a couple of their assemblies. I actually know the SBOs pretty well, and so I've had a lot of great experiences with that because I can get ins in the high school. And then I was able to teach a class at the Forum Hair School Academy. I taught a class on goals and executing goals. That was a really cool opportunity. I volunteered at the Grant School Carnival, and I can't wait to have more opportunities to do this in the future. This year is going to be awesome, and I'm so excited. So what is to come? These are just a few things that are on my calendar right now. I am going to create connections with the Murray citizens at the Murray Haunted Trails next week. So I hope to see you guys there as well. I'll have my little miss there too. Her name's Kirsten. You'll see a picture of her on the next slide. And also, I am going to be handing out prizes at the Murray Literary Spooky Contest. And visiting several classrooms in Murray to teach youth about creating goals, executing them, and the importance of staying in school and getting an education. I am going to be doing a trunk or treat for the Utah Food Allergy Network here in Murray at the Holiday Instacare. It's here in Murray. And then my 5K that I want to do, and many ribbon cuttings and so much more. So I am so excited. I am here to serve Murray City in any and all capacities. I am dedicated to creating relationships with the citizens of Murray. I am committed to being a role model for the youth in Murray City. And I am devoted to serving Murray City as a whole in any way possible. So if you guys need anything, or if you want me to attend any events, just email me. My email is up there. I would love to attend anything. And that's actually my little miss, Kirsten. She is so adorable. She actually just got glasses. They're bigger than her whole face. She's so stinking cute. So I hope that you guys had the chance to meet her as well, because she is absolutely adorable. And thank you for your continued support for the Miss Murray organization. It seriously does change life. It seriously does change lives, and it gives women the opportunity to have a voice. And I'm so grateful for that. So thank you. And I can't wait for this year.
Thank you so much. It was so wonderful having both Miss Murray's and Miss Lloyd. Wonderful seeing you. And again, you're welcome to stay or to tiptoe out if you wish. Next up, we'll be considering a proclamation for Lung Cancer Screening Month. Diane.
Thank you. Okay, November is Lung Cancer Screening Month, and so I will read this proclamation. It is a joint proclamation of the Mayor and Municipal Council of Murray City. Whereas lung cancer is the leading cause of cancer death among men and women in the United States and in Utah in 2021, accounting for more deaths than colon cancer, breast cancer, and prostate cancer combined. Whereas, according to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, there were 1,369 new lung cancer cases and 927 deaths because of lung cancer between 2013 and 2017 in Salt Lake County. Whereas, the five-year survival rate for localized lung cancer is 59%, yet only 17% of lung cancers are diagnosed at this stage. Whereas, screening for lung cancer for high-risk individuals using low-dose computed tomography can lead to the earlier detection of lung cancer and save lives, reducing the mortality by 20% when compared to screening by chest X-ray in the National Lung Screening Trial, and reducing the risk of death at 10 years by 24% in men and 33% in women, as demonstrated by another large randomized trial. Whereas, funding for lung cancer research trials are trails far behind funding for research of many other cancers, and additional research is needed in early diagnosis, screening, and treatment for lung cancer, as well as in lung cancer affecting women and lung cancer health disparities. Whereas lung cancer incidence is decreasing twice as fast in men as it is in women. Each year, more women die from lung cancer than breast cancer. And by 2035, more women will die from lung cancer than men. Whereas African Americans have the highest lung cancer incidence and mortality of all races, and disparities in lung cancer screening, diagnosis, treatment, and mortality are well characterized among African Americans and other racial minorities. Whereas lung cancer in never smokers is the seventh leading cause of cancer-related death and accounts for 17,000 to 26,000 deaths in the U.S. every year. 60 to 70% of never smokers diagnosed with lung cancer are women, and the proportion of lung cancers diagnosed in never smokers is increasing in the U.S. Whereas organizations working in the Murray community, such as the American Lung Cancer Screening Initiative and Women's Lung Cancer Forum, are committed to educating about lung cancer and lung cancer screening, and working to increase lung cancer screening rates in Murray. Therefore, Mayor D. Blair Camp and the Murray City Council do hereby proclaim November 2021 as Lung Cancer Awareness Month in Murray, and recognize the need for research in lung cancer affecting women and lung cancer health disparities, and encouraging all citizens to learn about lung cancer and early detection through lung cancer screening. Dated this 19th day of October, 2021.
Thank you, Diane. And do we need to take any action on that?
Yes.
Yes. So I'll take a motion.
I will move to make a motion. Sorry, I had like a little brain fart there. Make a motion to consider a proclamation for Lung Cancer Screening Month.
I'll second that.
Thank you. Brooke?
Aye.
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 Aye. Thank you.
Thank you for approving this proclamation. I really appreciate it. It's particularly poignant for me since my mother died 20 years ago of lung cancer. So thank you, Council.
Thank you, Diane.
Yes, thank you for sharing. Next up, we have citizen comments. Now, we do have three public hearings after this, so if you're wanting to speak on one of those, there will be an opportunity after each of the public hearings. But for citizen comments, we'll take comments now, limited to 3 minutes. You'll step to the microphone, state your name and city of residence, and you will need to fill out the required form that you can get from Jennifer, and she'll also be timing if you choose to speak. So if anyone is here for a citizen comment, you may stand now.
My name is Lawrence Horman. You've seen me here before. I realize I probably get up and speak every time I come in citizen comment, but then your council meetings are held less frequently than the counties are, so I don't get up there as often. As I have stated in the past, I encourage the city to become a leader in serving and working with the homeless, encouraging other cities to do so within the county, spread out the services, make it easier on everybody for the homeless to become housed, to become self-supporting, to become contributing members where they can't at this time because of the circumstances, to encourage other cities not to do sweeps, but to spend their time, their money, and their effort on finding ways to help those who are unhoused to get housed so that they can become productive members. I encourage you to look at and reinterpret ordinances to allow those who have family members who are in motorhomes, RVs, campers, to allow them to be on their properties as long as they're properly and well maintained, so they can help out as well. It will cut costs to do these things far better than trying to build more resource centers, homeless shelters, and continued police sweeps. And it will allow people to focus on getting their situation bettered rather than finding a new place to hide or a new place to stay for the night or the week or the month. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Council. I'm Jenna Strobel in District 3, and I am giving you a comment about your business item, which won't have a public comment opportunity. So on the Design Review Committee, I would like to ask that the council consider not having it be moved to being a minimum requirement of an annual meeting, but at least semi-annual. And I think when we move it down to being just an annual requirement, we really are taking away the viability and the meaning of that committee, and that eventually it would quickly go away. And so to help with the viability of that committee, I would like to ask that the council look at broadening the scope of that committee and have that committee include discussing improvement of what is already downtown, because most of the downtown is already built. So what we can do to help with that, I think one of the things that the committee could do is help with facade grants, which can be done through the Main Street program. That is a program that was just put in place again. It had been in the state before, and now it was just put in place again by the state legislator. And actually, the applications to have a city be considered for that program is October 31st. So this is the last city council meeting about that. But so that's one of the things that could really be done to help improve the look of our downtown is facade grants. So I urge the city to support programs like that and to help broaden the scope of one of the committees that could be a viable part in that and help it improve all of our downtown instead of just projects that are to be built. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Good evening, Mayor and council members and citizens. I appreciate being here. And I wanted to mention one thing about the fact that the accessory dwelling units now are supposed to be legal as of October 1. We should have some time element to look at how that might affect the community over time. And then considering the short-term rental as another thing, given the timing of the challenges to our wonderful and respected police officers, that many cities are trying to hire them away, and we don't want that to happen. So I think that that should be some consideration. Starting too many new things all at once, it takes time. And the fact that many of the citizens do not know about the short-term rental topic that it has been deferred and a decision until next year. But I think more notice to the public should be given on that. But also the biggest concern is you don't want to take away business from our commercial occupants, our commercial businesses in the city now. And I think they're probably having a challenging time given all the shutdowns and lack of travel and travel prohibitions. And anyway, there's just a lot of changes going on. So I would just caution to take a little bit slower. One thing of congestion, pardon me, that I'm concerned about that will be happening is the plan to widen the streets going from Highland Drive down through 9th East. Part of that is already widened. And the people, a couple of residents I've talked to said that traffic is much faster now that that section has been widened. If you have the whole straight from Highland Drive all the way down to 9th East with a middle turn lane, every study I've read has the idea that if you don't think you're going to have to stop, you go faster. Already, cars are going faster. But the biggest concern I have of all is the elementary schools. There are three elementary schools that will be affected by faster traffic when you have another highway. And I asked one of the contractors talking about the widening in the street, what are the safety concerns for residential areas with highways? She brought over a 41-page document that was about for having a solid middle turn lane. And I started reading it and reading it. It's all for highways. We really don't need a highway in the middle of, we've already got Van Winkle on one side, just a few, it starts at Highland Drive and goes at a diagonal. The other is the 215 is right a few blocks to the south. And I want you to think about the congestion that's going to occur when people go from 9th heading west on 5900 south, because Vine goes into 59 right there. You're going to have to take out a whole row of housing. Well, that's not going to be good. We're trying to get more housing. Anyway, thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments this evening? All right, thank you to everyone who spoke. We'll move on to our public hearings, as there's nothing on the consent agenda. The first public hearing is consider a resolution adopting the 2021 Parks, Trails, and Recreation Facilities Plan, and we've got Kim Sorensen presenting.
Thank you, Council and Mayor, for your time. So as we spoke a couple of weeks ago about the adoption of the park impact fees, we're here to ask you to reconsider a resolution adopting park impact fees. And I'll just recap a few of the key items with the impact fees. So the impact fee for a single family unit would be $5,396. Multifamily would be $4,965. A couple of highlights with the impact fees: they cannot be used for operation and maintenance or staffing. The fees will be used to facilitate growth and maintain current service levels within our parks and recreation system. Fees must be spent within 6 years after they're collected. And there is a 90-day grace period if you adopt tonight before the fees can be charged. So the staff is recommending the impact fees. Our Parks and Recreation Advisory Board has met and given it a unanimous approval. A couple of those members are here this evening if for support, and I'm open to questions.
Can you repeat the number for single families?
Single family is 5,396.
Thank you.
I was going to ask this the other night, and I forgot. Can these monies be used to, and I think I know the answer, but to upgrade current parks, new playgrounds, things like that?
So that's a great question. They cannot be used to upgrade parks. They have to be new parks, new playgrounds, pickleball courts, trails.
So not new playgrounds on an existing park?
On an existing park, yes.
Okay, that's what I meant.
Some of the monies can be used to, like, put in a playground where there's not a playground. Is that what you're asking? We would just have to deduct the value of that green space.
And when we collect the fees, can you kind of talk a little bit about that process and what we can, what if a developer comes in, what an alternative method could be? Or
so, yeah, good question. So when a developer comes in, they would pay the fees when they get their building permit. Now you're asking in lieu of the fees if they can build a park, and the answer is yes, and that would be done on a case-by-case situation. The key there is the park would need to be accessible by all citizens, so it would need to be in our park system. So a developer couldn't build a playground that only served their development.
And then we would still service that location. Okay.
And you're like talking an HOA, then they would not be able to do that.
Park on an HOA most likely would not qualify because it only services the HOA.
Okay.
No, thank you. I know I've really wanted this initiative, so I appreciate the staff and yourself for putting it together and the board for approving it. So thank you for being here.
Thank you.
All right. Did you have a...
Are you ready for a motion?
No, I was going to open it to, but I thought Dale was leaning towards the mic, so I was deferring to that. If there aren't any other questions from the council, I'll open it to the public. If there's any public comments for this hearing, now is the time.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Sunshine Zedley. I'm the current chairperson for the Parks and Recreation Advisory Board. This has been a huge topic of discussion. And as we talked about this, I reflected on one of my first experiences with the Parks and Recreation Board. We were planning to put in something that is now referred to as the Murray City Canal Trail. Doesn't connect to the Jordan River Parkway, if that's what you're thinking about. This particular trail serves our Murray East sort of annex citizens. And it was extremely important to us because that area of our city has a dense population and not as many green spaces as I would like. So when we put this idea out to the residents that it would affect, whose property bordered on the trail we wanted to construct, we got a lot of feedback. I had been on the board for about maybe 2 weeks and was asked if I could attend a open house where this, but I know why they always are throwing me under the bus. It's constant. So I showed up, and sometimes the opposing voices are a bit louder than the pro voices. And that was somewhat the case at this particular open house meeting that we had at a high school in Cottonwood. So there was some people that were very opposed to this particular trail going in, as they thought it might increase negative traffic in and out of these neighborhoods that they lived in. If you haven't had a chance to take a walk on the canal trail, you access it via Wheeler Farm. It's in the south. You know, you access it in the corner. If you're on pavement, you're in the wrong spot. It's beautiful. It's serene. There's a couple of crossings. Not a big deal. I'm on it a lot. It's a great runner's trail. Strollers work. So do little kid bikes. And it's not very highly populated. At the end of this trail is what I wanted to talk to you about. If you're wondering if this is something that you want to endorse, there was a private residence that owned somewhat of a small farm where the trail terminates. If you've been on it, you're going along and you're like, this is great. And all of a sudden it just stops. Well, this private residence, out of like just the divine intervention, went up for sale. We're talking about a couple of acres of prime real estate in the city of Murray. It was big bucks. But we wanted to secure that particular piece of property to turn it into a green space where this trail would terminate. We didn't have the money. I was the one who put forth the motion that we buy that property, even if we didn't have the money to, you know, do the landscaping and all the other, you know, playground type things. I wanted that green space for those people in our Murray East communities who don't have as much of that delightful, just serenity type places where they can go. We didn't have the money. It got sold to commercial developers. The homes are beautiful. A park would be better. If we are able to do what we as a board envision we can do with this money, it does nothing but make our amazing city that much better. Thank you.
Thank you, Coach Sunshine. Any other comments? All right, seeing none, I will close the public hearing, and I am ready for a motion if there's no further discussion.
I'll make a motion that we approve a resolution adopting the 2021 Parks, Trails, Recreation Facilities Plan.
I'll second.
Brooke?
Aye.
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 Aye. Thank you. All right, next up, our next public hearing is consider an ordinance repealing sections 13.08.050 and 13.22.280 and 13.48.055 and 15.22.110 of the Murray City Municipal Code and amending and renumbering Chapter 13.06 of the Murray City Municipal Code to Chapter 3.14 related to impact fees and including the enactment of a parks, trail, and recreation impact fee.
Okay, thanks again. So in a nutshell, this is basically asking you to approve an ordinance adding the wording into the code book so that we can charge park impact fees.
Any questions?
That's in a nutshell.
In a nutshell. It is a public hearing. Would any members of the public like to speak? You have 3 minutes. Yeah, go ahead.
Hello. My name is Ted Maestas, and I think the impact fees are long overdue in this city. I've worked with several cities throughout the state and in seven other states, and impact fees are what give the city the ability to either continue or pick up new space and develop areas for their citizens to play in after the hard work. I'm happy that the council has listened to this and that we continue in that effort to submit impact fees to developers. Thank you.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to speak? Seeing none, I will close this public hearing. And if there's no further discussion, I'm open to a motion.
I will make the motion, but I have a question. I don't know if this is Kim's or the board's. How long have you guys been working on this? Ooh, you guys took a master class.
So when we had the master plan completed early 2020, I guess it is, 21.
So in, yeah, it was probably our first year.
Anyway, in the master plan, they covered real quickly funding for future parks. And this was mentioned in that as well as our CIP budget and a couple other things. So we've been working on it for a little over a year.
Thank you. Okay, well, I will make the motion since Dale has deferred it to us. But I will consider an ordinance repealing sections 13.08.05, 13.22.280, 13.48.005, and 15.22.110 of the Murray City Municipal Code, and amending and renumbering Chapter 13.06 of the Murray City Municipal Code to Chapter 3.14 related to impact fees and including the enhancement of parks, trails, and recreation impact fees.
I will.
Oh, adopt. Sorry.
I was going to say I was going to motion to adopt that. So
yes.
I motion to adopt that motion. I'll move to second. Thank you.
Thank you. Brooke.
Aye.
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 Aye. Thank you. And thank you to the advisory board for coming and speaking today.
Yeah, thank you.
And for all of your other work. I know it's more than just this one moment. public hearing, our third one of the day, is consider an ordinance related to land use. Amends the general plan, Chapter 5, Land Use and Urban Design, to include village mixed use and centers mixed use zones. Melinda and Jared presenting.
All right. It should be right. Let's see. Sorry. Is Miss Murray still here? No. Just does.
Yeah, that was, who said that about department heads?
I feel like she should know.
Maybe she's watching, Jared.
Yeah. Thank you. Thanks, Council, Mayor, everyone. We're here to, to hold the public hearing about the general plan amendment, the text of Chapter 5 in the general plan, which is land use and urban design. This is, if I can, I'll leave it on this slide for just a second. This is a housekeeping item for the VMU and CMU zones that were adopted earlier this year. They are not represented in our future land use map and our general plan because they weren't part of our code when we wrote those plans and adopted those plans. So I'm just going to briefly describe how this works. This is a segment of our zoning map, and it shows the CD zone. You can see the TOD zone. Notably absent from this map in all these places is the, are the VMU or CMU zones because they are not adopted anywhere. They have not been applied anywhere in the city. Our zoning map is informed by the general plan's future land use map, which has similar categories. City center, that's the center of town, the MCCD zone corresponds to it. And mixed use, this purple color, that's up around the track station, the Murray North track station, Fireclay area, around the central station. Those have been applied. And so those future land use categories in Chapter 5 correspond to certain zones. And what we're proposing in conjunction with, well, we're proposing creating a new future land use category specifically for the VMU and CMU zones, village mixed use and centers mixed use. And we have creatively proposed to call that the village and centers mixed use designation. It would correspond to those two new zones. And then we would propose at the same time, in conjunction with doing that, retitling this currently labeled mixed use as transit oriented mixed use category. So it, it kind of defines that there is a difference between those types of zones. The as you recall, probably from a couple of months ago when these were adopted, these VMU and CMU zones, we would look at criteria for adopting them or implementing them where certain conditions exist. One of those conditions being that was identified, that those properties were identified in the general plan, in some of our mapping in the general plan, as areas of transition, regional centers, city retail centers, et cetera. So that kind of helps also then, again, sorry, just to point out that these areas, for example, have been identified as city centers or retail centers, and they are not located close to the transit corridors in the middle of town, to the transit stations here that you can see, or even the BRT along State Street that, that will come in the future. So they are different. So we're proposing transit mixed use and village and centers mixed use so that that can be applied where we intend to allow perhaps a zone change to village mixed use and centers mixed use. I hope that makes sense. If you have any questions, please let me know. The Planning Commission did hold a public hearing on this matter on September 2nd. They did vote to recommend approval to the council. Again, it is kind of a housekeeping item. We've adopted those zones, so the that sort of implies that we will have a category for them in the future land use and the mapping there. So we are recommending, based on those findings that basically say what I just said, this is part of what we kind of considered, that you approve that proposed amendment to Chapter 5, the land use and urban design element of the 2017 general plan, to include that new category and make the adjustment to the existing mixed use category.
I just have a question, and this doesn't really pertain to this voting here, but do we have any in our mixed use zones? Do we have any categories that don't allow for apartments?
No, by definition, the mixed use zones would include multifamily and commercial.
So that's the case throughout. Does that have to be the case in every? Because I'm just curious to know if that's usually where I get my biggest concerns is saying like bring about apartments, which sometimes it's needed, but I'm just curious if there's a category that does not have with mixed use that doesn't have apartments. I realize that mixed use, what it does, what it implies, but
sure. We don't actually use a category of mixed use that's like you're describing, but sometimes people will talk about mixed use and they mean mixes of commercial and office allowances, et cetera. Our commercial zoning allows offices anyway, and our office zone allows certain commercial. So there's really no, we haven't used that kind of zone.
Yeah. Okay.
We're slightly more urban than suburban areas, in really suburban areas, far flung, you might see those kinds of zones. We haven't used it.
Thanks, Jared.
Thanks.
Jared, can you kind of explain the density ranges, whereas before it was 10 to 30 and
sure.
The transit mixed use, we're looking at increasing it from 40 to 80, is that correct?
Right. That's to put it in line with what we've approved in the zones, that what the zones would actually allow. When we did this in the general plan, it was considering the density that's listed there was considering the whole area that transit mixed use or that mixed use areas might cover, where the designation might be as an overall density. And that's often the case. A single project might be approved at 60 or 80 units the acre, but the area that it's in, when you consider it, might still only be 15 units the acre because there are commercial properties that don't have any residential components. So when you take the whole area, you're at those lower densities that were shown in the general plan originally. We felt like that was a weird way to think about it, when what people think about, what people see is a project that is being built at this density, 60 units per acre, 80 units per acre. It's useful in some instances to talk about an area's overall density, absolutely, especially in terms of public facilities, utilities, et cetera. And we talk about that a lot with the public works personnel. But it's not particularly useful for a project, and that's what most people are familiar with, is not the whole area's density, but what that project's coming in at. So we wanted to make it match what the zoning allows as opposed to the area that it's applied to. And we've done the same thing with village and centers, incidentally, right. too. So those numbers that you see at the bottom for density in village and centers are the range that's allowed between the two of those zones. Both of them don't allow up to 45. The village and centers only allows up to 35, but the two zones together, bottom out at 25 and top out.
Can you remind us what it was when you guys did the original proposal after the memorandum?
I'm not sure what you mean.
So we were presented this after the memorandum, right?
This after the moratorium.
The moratorium, sorry.
Right. No, no problem.
Moratorium.
This is. Do you mean the density that was allowed?
Mm-hmm.
These were the densities that we
proposed. That was it. Okay.
Yeah.
Just making sure. And then can you just tell us what areas of the city these are located in?
Sure.
So we have a visual of that.
So right now, they aren't anywhere. But in the future, what would guide this council's decision and the planning commission's decision on making recommendations would be a couple of different things. First and foremost would be that they need to be along there in the purpose statements. It says, well, actually, I can read it in this because we use the purpose statement to say this. Oops, sorry. They need to be located along transportation corridors, high volume corridors. We wouldn't expect to, for example, go into the middle of a neighborhood that doesn't have any transportation going through it or larger corridor going through it, an arterial, at least a minor arterial or a large collector, and think that this was appropriate. So as you look at the mapping, that's the first question is, State Street is a great location for this kind of zone. Less density than a transit-oriented mixed-use zone would allow, but more than what's allowed currently, which is no residential, not a home, not an apartment, not anything. They were designed to be implemented in areas that need to be redeveloped that are already commercial or non-residential in nature. So that's the along corridors part. In those areas, they might be appropriate, but they may not. They need to be around centers that kind of exist, larger intersections or places where collectors cross arterials or where the BRT line is, for example, or areas that were just identified as areas where some change, albeit a change to mixed use, would allow the redevelopment of sort of commercial that's lagging behind or having trouble keeping up, but at lower densities, like that 25 or 30 units to the acre, that doesn't create such an impact because it's in an area of the city that's more on the east side or more on the west side, where it's further out from that transit corridor. So those are the areas where you might see people asking for those kinds of land use map amendments and the zone map amendments. That's the first consideration. And then we did adopt those 9 tests to kind of say, will adding mixed use here instead of the commercial that's there currently, will adding mixed use do one of or 5 of these 9 things? Will it help get the commercial that's there and lagging behind? Will it help revitalize it? Will it keep significant portions of it? Will it improve connections to the neighborhood so that people that live in a neighborhood near here can better bike or walk to that area and reduce the traffic? It's all those same kind of goals, reducing traffic and increasing services, but at densities that are not so intrusive.
Okay, thank you. And then can you kind of talk about the process of once a developer or someone comes in for, yeah. and what that process looks like?
Sure. So the first thing a developer would need to do under the rules that we have, and this doesn't really modify the rules of the zoning, the first thing they need to do is ask to change the future land use map to say one of these two zones could be considered. Most of the time that happens in conjunction with the zone change. So we'd be looking at future land use map amendments to this village and centers, and a zoning map amendment to either VMU or CMU that are sort of appropriate for those. And then we would, as a city, we'd want to consider those tests that I mentioned and whether it's along the right kind of corridors, if it matches up to this kind of mapping from the general plan, if it's considerable. If the zone were changed by ordinance, so if the council adopted the zone change and said, okay, let's say the VMU can be, we can change these properties to VMU zoning. In order to do a development of any kind, we have the VMU and CMU zones require their approval process is called master site plan approval. You can't make a master site plan approval under the code that was adopted in August. It's been kind of a blurry year, but I think in August, July, thanks. In July, you can't make an application as a developer for a master site plan approval without having that application accompanied by a traffic impact study, a parking analysis, and an adequate public facilities review with our utilities departments to make sure that the density that is being allowed can be handled by all of those different kind of systems, that the parking has been looked at, and we want those applications for development to come in with those kind of questions already answered, because they have significant impacts on how much density you actually do, whether you're allowed 30 or 35. If we can't service that 35 units per acre, there's no sense in approving a project for that and finding out after the fact from public works that it doesn't work. So that's the process, and then that would go through the planning commission. And I'm sorry, but there's one more
level.
If that master site plan approval comes in with those different tests or those different studies, and we can review it, we'll review it and make revisions or whatever and take it to the planning commission for master site plan approval. But they're also required to do a master site plan agreement. That's a kind of a development agreement with the city, and the council has to review that because you're the ones who enter those kinds of contracts. So you would look at a master site plan agreement that would have been set up kind of by the planning commission's approval, make sure that what the planning commission required of them as a developer, the order that they put the improvements in, the kinds of improvements they put in, the density that they're allowed, the parking spaces that they're required to do, that is all contained in that agreement and ordered in the right way. And that's the final step, is that the council would have to review and approve that master site plan agreement.
Thank you. No, I have another question.
Go ahead. I just wonder, how long is that process approximately? I mean, that's a lot of
It's a lot of work. The first step, zone change, zone changes usually take about 90 days,
right,
to get through the hearing processes, at least, yeah.
But this will... Yeah.
And then after that, to do those studies takes some time.
Wow.
So they'll want to be confident that they're getting the zone change before
they would never, right,
those studies. So they might be another 6 months doing those studies, wow, if they're fast, maybe a few. And then we don't want to take projects. One of the other requirements for a project is it has to be at least 3 acres. So these are all master site plan processes, a longer process. They'll be working more with staff up front, making sure that everything's lined up and working before we take it to the planning commission. And then it's got to go through a couple of meetings with the city council to get a master site plan agreement put in place. These are year-long projects probably, yeah.
Okay, one last question, because visually I just want to see this.
Yeah. And
maybe see if you really got it, Jared. So we'll use this property, for example. How many acres is this property?
Here?
Yeah. The property that we own here on this block.
Uh-huh. 6.7? 6.5? Yeah.
6.5. On a 6.5 within this new change, which could be considered for this zone, how many units would that be?
Well, it's already zoned MCCD, which would allow...
Oh, 80, that's right. Okay, so then...
allow 80 to the acre. But if it were...
Uh-huh. But if it were...
If it were zoned CMU, the center's mixed use would, uh-huh, probably be the one that makes more sense here. CMU would allow up to 45 units to the acre.
So in total... 40 units, so just 40 times 6, I guess?
Yeah. So 40 instead of 80?
Instead of 80. Yeah. But yeah, a thing to remember with density of any kind, whether you're talking about 30 units to the acre, 25 units to the acre, or 100 units to the acre, that is the maximum allowable density. There are a lot of things that go into that.
Right.
We have yet to review a single project that maxes out the density that's allowed in any quarter of the city where we've allowed up to 100 units the acre, 80 units the acre. We've seen them at 60 and 70. The construction gets expensive, mm-hmm, it gets more expensive after that. The parking for those gets very expensive after that. It's I don't want to say it's not possible to max out the density, but it's everything to max out that density requires a lot of you as a developer too, and it increases your costs exponentially. And at 40 units the acre, it may not really bear out in terms of cost.
Right.
Particularly with the park impact fee. do the math on the new park impact fee. That's a lot of money.
Yeah.
Which is good, because as you increase density, we need to increase open space and activity in the city. Absolutely. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, I just kind of wanted to get a visual. I know we've had the discussion about infrastructure, and that's a really big, I guess, concern in my district that I've heard over and over again is infrastructure and water.
Right, and that's a great point. And if I may, yeah. I'll just
yes, please.
That for just 1 second. So these densities that were proposed and adopted in the VMU and CMU zones take into account the constraints of. We're going to make people do adequate public facilities reviews as they come in for projects. But the larger, broader work on that was done as we did the work in the moratorium. So the densities we settled on were the densities we felt from the studies that we have and were undertaking at the time could be supported overall in the areas. The same goes for where we're sitting right now. In the MCCD, when that zone was applied, capital improvements plans were put in place to support up to 80 units the acre, 100 units the acre overall in the area. So we're still within the abilities of our systems to provide water and sewer. There are different challenges that arise in certain projects. If you put it in a certain part of the zone, you might have to do different things. We've identified certain upgrades we'd need to make. Those are all part of those master plans now. We should be able to handle the water needs and the infrastructure needs.
Thank you.
If there were to be a situation where the public facilities could not adequately handle the proposed or requested zone, it wouldn't receive a positive recommendation from staff. An applicant could still submit the application and ask that we take it on to the Planning Commission and the City Council, but it would be done with a negative recommendation. And most sensible developers would not be interested in going through that process without a positive recommendation for staff. So that's the whole process that we have set up through the zone revisions that we put in place earlier this year, is that gives a more, I think, stringent opportunity for Public Works to request studies, require studies versus just requesting them. But that's something that we do. I mean, that's fundamentally the most basic part of our jobs when an application comes in is we do that review. Can it be sustainable? Can it be put into place and still serve the citizens? Yes or no? And if it's a no, most likely we'll never have an application that would come forward through this process. That does happen on a rare occasion, but we take care of that on the front end. And most of the time, if it were to be something that wouldn't be supported by the infrastructure, an application would never move forward.
One last question to that is, at what point does the public are they notified of that process, or are they?
Do you mean the whole
if there's an application that comes through, is that the Planning Commission or is that the council?
First,
how are they notified?
Zone change applications to the Planning Commission. And those notices go out depending on the size of the properties. They're all 3 acres or more, so 500 feet. We notify.
Do you remember what the code is on that and how far out we go?
500 feet if you're 3 acres or more.
500? Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
Any other questions? Seeing none, I'll open it, this public hearing up to the public. If there are any comments, you may go to the microphone at the podium. Yeah, go ahead. You may have to, are you still back? The microphone. There you go. You got it.
Janice, this is your home. You should have just sat down there in that chair.
She knew how to set it up. Sorry, Janice.
Hi, Council. Thanks and good evening again. So back on July 20th this year, 3 months ago from now, you, as our City Council, approved the mixed-use zoning ordinance that the staff had diligently prepared during the moratorium. And knowing that the moratorium was soon to expire, you recognize that these changes were a vast improvement over what was in place previously in our city's ordinance for mixed-use. But as a council, at that time, you also expressed quite a few concerns over some of the details and wished to be able to work through those details as quickly as possible and improve the mixed-use ordinances that got approved that night. So that sentiment of not yet having yet worked through the new mixed-use ordinances, but asking when it would happen, was expressed again just 2 weeks ago during the last Committee of the Whole. Well, Committee of the Whole 2 weeks ago. So yet here we are tonight, where the council is being asked to amend the general plan with the mixed-use zoning as it currently is written, without any of the details having been addressed yet that the council wanted to work through with the staff. And since July, the city has received a lot of feedback from the community, primarily from the feedback opportunity that was provided for the 48th Street proposal. And your citizens have expressed concerns with the direction that mixed-use developments are taking our city, downtown and elsewhere. So tonight, I know it, like Jared said, it's just a housekeeping formality here, but I'm asking the council to not amend the general plan at this premature stage of the ordinance's formation. This will help the citizens that you represent know that your earnestness to improve the city's mixed-use ordinance, the mixed-use ordinances, before they become cemented as a more permanent part of our city in the general plan. So even though things will have to move forward as they are because it is in the ordinance, I do ask that you recognize that you can make a gesture that the public can recognize by not amending the general plan with the mixed-use ordinances as they are currently written, seeing that there was a lot of desire to work through details before it was really cemented. Thank you.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to speak on the issue?
Hello, I'm Clark Bullen, a citizen of District 3. I recommend the council not add those zoning distinctions to the general plan as of yet. The council itself said that there were adjustments that they wanted to make to these zones before they were used, and that there were concerns that they had. I believe the council should wait until they have had the opportunity to review these zones and make appropriate adjustments before they are added to the general plan, in accordance with what the council and the citizens want to see for Murray City. In the considerations of these mixed-use zones, I recommend the council consider all of the areas that are already zoned for much higher density and how the additional zones could add balance to the equation in our community and maybe alleviate some of the concerns that have been expressed by citizens about mixed-use zones and higher density. They could be used as a tool instead of something for the community to be afraid of. For some context, the Point at 53rd is looking to get a zoning change at the planning and zoning meeting with 13.22 acres. That's up to 595 units with center mixed use. RC Willie with 9.11 acres, that's up to 318 units with village mixed use. City Hall, as Councilwoman Dominguez mentioned, 6.5 acres, 292 units with center mixed use, up to 520 units with transit-oriented district mixed use. Should there be a lower density zone for mixed use, as Councilman Hales mentioned, as we add these to the master plan, should that be considered before we do so? I also strongly urge the council to bring citizens into these conversations early, now, so that they can have community buy-in from the onset and discuss the challenges, but also the benefits that these zones could potentially bring to different areas of Murray, instead of waiting until they're about to be approved and then possibly running into issues at that time. Thank you.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to speak on the issue? All right, seeing none, I will close the public hearing and turn back to the council for discussion. Is there any discussion?
I'm curious, just for my sake, this is called a clean. I don't know what you call it. What did you call it? A
housekeeping.
Housekeeping. I was going to say cleanup, but housekeeping item.
I'll address this to you or GL or whoever, but if we were to vote no on that, does that stop the mixed use in this on these, those specifically those two developments that were talked about, Arcewilly and Point at 53rd?
So let me address that question with the inverse. Approving this doesn't mean the council would not be able to implement changes to the zones that exist right now. That is always a possibility. The difficult part is we now have zoning ordinances on the book that don't have a corresponding area with the future land use map and the general plan. So if there were to be an application to amend the general plan to the future land use category that doesn't exist, I don't know how we would handle that, but I think it would get pretty complicated pretty quickly. And I would defer to GL to, like, I don't know.
So let me just start with this. This would not stop a pending application. No, or an application to come later. The general plan is advisory. And as nice as it would have been to have this in at the same time we did the ordinance, you'll recall that we were given 6 months for the moratorium. That's not a lot of time to do the massive amount of work that Linda and Jared did. And then as we discussed this, about the time we changed the ordinances and adopted these new ones, we talked about future tweaks and things. Those are not going to come overnight either. That's also a massive amount of work and time. You're probably talking 6 months to a year before you really can get that into place. And so I think that what's fair to say is the city did the best that it could under the circumstances to get something palatable in the meantime, if not good. And sure, happy to revisit this, but you're not going to see any wholesale changes in 2 weeks or this year at all. So when Jared says this is house cleaning, we've already passed the ordinance that will allow someone to come in and rezone a place. We prefer to have it consistent with the general plan or to have a general plan supporting that. But the fact that we don't does not mean that those just stop.
And in approving this again, like it would not mean that the council couldn't make changes to the zones. It also wouldn't mean that the council couldn't approve an application for a zone map amendment and a general plan amendment somewhere in the area. But once that zoning is in place, even when that zoning is in place, the council could still make changes to an ordinance. The vesting doesn't happen until an actual project application is submitted. And going back to what Jared was explaining just a moment ago, like that on a really easy project takes 4, 5, 6 months. On complicated projects, there's back and forth between my staff and developer and property owners for 6 months, 9 months, a year. As an example, we passed the exclusive negotiation with Edlin with RDA a year ago, November. We still don't have a project application submitted. That is very common for these projects to take that long to come to fruition. So the vesting is what then puts an applicant in a place where even if changes were made going forward, they're not subject to those changes. They're vested in the application. And again, as an example, which will be coming to you, the 4800 South Lofts, they had an application in for their project before the moratorium was initiated, before the changes that we made with those zoning ordinances. They're vested in the mixed use zone that was on the books pre-February of this year when the moratorium was put in place. So there's still understanding that the council wants to look at those zones again and those opportunities are available. The likelihood of a project coming in being vested before those changes are put in place is low, I would think, for the most part. But so that may be some comfort to the council on that point. But approving this, as GL mentioned, then provides an opportunity for the general plan to have some consistency. But we already have the zones on the books, which means anyone can apply for them. And we will process an application that comes in and they pay their fees, regardless of the outcome of this, because that's by law what we're required to do. It just would be much cleaner going forward to have a consistent category to put in place. It would be less confusing, I think, for the whole process, but we still have to process an application regardless of whether or not there's consistency with the general plan.
Thank you for the information and the expertise.
GL, can you tell me what is the process for tweaking and what can be tweaked?
So as I understood the discussion with the council previously, there were some concerns or ideas that you may want to look at, whether it be density, height, things like that. It's the same process we would use for any zoning or land use ordinance, which is typically what you'd want to do is have a discussion with the council to see what do you want tweaked. And once that happens, then staff would go back and amend the ordinance or ordinances, take it to the planning commission, get a recommendation, and then bring it to the council for a final decision.
Okay, and we had already mentioned some things, but that was not formal. It needs to be more formal.
It doesn't have to be, no, it doesn't have to be formal, but the staff wants to make sure they understand exactly what you're saying before they go back and do a lot of work. And so whether that's a committee of the whole or a workshop, whatever, staff's gonna wanna hear from you. What are all the things you wanna look at?
Okay. Great, thank you.
Any other questions? Seeing none, I will take a motion if you're ready.
Okay, I will move to adopt the ordinance related to land use, amends the general plan, chapter 5, land use and urban design to include village mixed use and centers mixed use zones.
Is there a second?
Before I second, I want to ask GL one more thing. I want to understand that regardless of what we do here, everything will go forward. The projects that have been mentioned, The Point, RC Willie, any other project that comes under the zoning that we changed will still go forward whether we do this or not.
It will. That's correct.
So this actually probably should have been done when we did the other, but this will make it easier on staff to get it done.
That's correct.
Okay, I'll second it.
Brooke?
Aye.
No. Nay.
Aye.
No.
Aye. All right. Moving on to business items. Consider an ordinance amending chapter 15.08 of the Murray City Municipal Code relating to building permits. We have Melinda and Karen presenting.
Super great. I am going to introduce to you tonight my phone-a-friend here, which is Karen Richards. Dawn Stephenson, the building official, is ill, and so Karen has graciously stepped in to assist with any questions you may have. Karen really is our office expert with the building division, and so appreciate her stepping in for Dawn tonight. This is another what we would call housekeeping item. One of the things that the building division is going to implement in the next, hopefully, couple of months is new software. We would be able to process building permit fees online. As we've gone through this process and really been looking at our building permit fees just really started earlier this year, we realized that there were some inconsistencies with the code, the plan review, and what we wanted to do was make it very evident to anybody who was going to submit a building permit fee what fees we were going to charge. And so there's a few requirements. The building code, the ICC building code, requires that the governing body of the local jurisdiction adopt the building division fees or the building permit fees. And so the most straightforward way we feel like to do that is to amend the chapter on the building division and include those fees right in the chapter. Building permit fees are pretty complicated in a lot of ways to calculate. Certainly exceeds my expertise, but there's two portions of building permit fees. And one is the amount of fees that is charged, and the other part is the math or the formulas behind those fees. And so we wanted to put in our city code straightforward, here's the fees, here's the formula that we use. And that really is what's before you today. We're really not changing the building permit fees. There's a couple of, I would say, minor increases where we're trying to be more consistent with a fee that we would send an inspector out, making sure that it's kind of the same fee across the board. So if we're charging $80 an hour in one area, we should be charging $80 an hour for another area, simply because it's the same staff, it's the same type of work that they're doing. Doesn't make sense to have a fee that's more when it's a like service for a like service. The other thing that I did want the council and the public to know is the building permit fees are intended to pay for the services that are rendered. So those permit fees that come in pay for the staff and the salaries and the contract work that we have performed with the plan reviews. It pays for the inspections. It pays for all of the services and all of the items that go along with that. So building division is a unique part of the city because it's self-supporting with the fees that come in. While at the same time, it's not an enterprise fund like the utility services. So if there's any questions about the specifics of the building permit fees or the changes that we've provided to you with the red lines that are in the city packet, let us know. We'd be more than happy to answer those questions.
As I read it, it just looked like it was being cleaned up. It didn't look like there were any changes in the context.
That's essentially correct. And again, one of the things that in the last few years, we've had several different building officials. One person leaves, another comes in, and it's kind of hard to pinpoint what are the fees that we charge. If it's all here in code, it's very evident there's no room for discrepancy. And so that's true. We're not changing the fees. We're just really confirming what they are and putting them in code so that if there's any changes or questions, it's right there. It's consistent.
Yeah. Look good to me.
Any questions? All right, then I will take a motion.
I'll make that motion. I move that we approve an ordinance amending Chapter 15.08 of the Murray City Municipal Code related to building permits.
I'll second.
Thank you. Brooke?
Aye.
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 Aye. All right, moving on to our last business item. Consider an ordinance amending Chapter 2.68 of the Murray City Municipal Code relating to the Murray City Center District Design Review Committee, Melinda and Jared.
So this is another housekeeping item that we would term when the council adopted the changes to the mixed use zones in July, the MCCD zone included. One of the changes that the council approved was a name change to what we have previously called the MCCD Design Review Committee. And we changed that in the MCCD code to simply say the MCCD Review Committee. This is a minor attempt to help clear up confusion that is associated with the word design. And a lot of people believe that to mean architectural style, the ordinance, the way it's written, the way the MCCD is set up really isn't meant to regulate that. It's more site, it's more pedestrian access, interplaying between parking and, more the pedestrian access. And so we felt like changing the name, dropping the design word would hopefully clear up some of that confusion. So that was done through the process with the MCCD or the moratorium, the MCCD zone that was approved in July. This is chapter 2.68 of the Murray City Code that essentially is the forming code for all of the boards and commissions that the city has, MCCD, Design Review Committee or Review Committee included. And so we needed to change this code to be consistent with the code changes and amendments that the council approved in July. The other item that we were proposing to change along with that is right now the code requires that meetings be held quarterly. Depending on when applications come in, we would prefer to have that be moved to an annual requirement, which we have with all of our boards and commissions, but with the understanding that that's a minimum amount of time or a minimum number of times that we would meet.
Can I make one clarifying point? Just because I think it's maybe something that's not familiar and I'm realizing it now. So we have scheduled, when we schedule our meetings for the year, planning commission, hearing officers, et cetera, we schedule 12 MCCD review committee meetings on the last Thursday of every month. They're scheduled that way. What we're talking about here with the quarterly requirement is not that you have to schedule 4 meetings a year. It's that you have to hold 4 meetings a year, regardless of whether you have applications or not. You have to have one meeting every quarter, no matter what. Only for people we don't like, we hold those applications for a while. We hold meetings every time there's an application. There have been months where we have a meeting every month for 3 or 4 months in a row, and then we don't have any applications for another 6 or 7 months. But we're required in those 6 or 7 months to hold another meeting by this quarterly requirement, even if we don't have applications. So it doesn't have anything to do with deciding whether we're going to take an application forward or make, we don't make anybody wait for the quarterly meeting. That's not how this works. And when we go, if we went to an annual meeting, our simple thinking in that was just to say, you got to have one meeting a year, even if you had no applications all year long, you need to elect a chair and vice chair and say, here we are. And we have annual training that has to happen. The attorneys have to give us open public meetings training, and we like to talk to them about, we have one training meeting a year where we talk about design elements and things like that. So that was the thinking behind going to annual as opposed to quarterly required meetings. So I wanted to make that distinction. I don't know if we made that very clear when we first talked about it. It's just not something that we talk about a lot. Sorry.
Thank you, Jared. That brought a lot of clarity. That was helpful for me. Any questions? Discussion?
Well, we had discussed that at the Committee of the Whole because I was concerned about that as well. So that's helped. That clarification is very helpful.
I wondered if maybe I had misunderstood that. I'm just, as I was listening to Melinda explain it again, I thought, oh, I wonder if I'm hearing this. I mean, I hear these things the same way that you all do. So I'm just making sure that we're on the same wavelength.
Thank you.
I'll take a motion if there's no questions.
Can we have a discussion before
Absolutely.
A motion? I would propose that we wait at least at the very minimum until we have our tour to better understand what we are looking at for MCCD and the changes that we are looking to make within that zone. You know, we already know I have a lot of concerns with MCCD, and at the very minimum, if we can just hold off.
Does that hold you up with it? Okay. Jared, I just want to make sure Jared's shaking his head no. Okay.
I didn't honestly even know that it was necessary until Susan pointed it out. Susan's very good at that. She's like, there's a whole other title that names these things, and it's all wrong now because of what you did in 17. No, it's not.
Okay, so I guess I will make the motion to delay this vote and move it. Maybe I guess we'd have to look at the calendar and discuss it with the chair and go from there when to reschedule.
We do have the tour scheduled, right?
On the 29th.
We do, yes, okay.
Yeah, so we can.
So we can come back to this. So what would that just be the motion to delay and defer until tabling? Yeah. So that's my motion to table this item for now.
Did you want to have a date certain to come back or leave?
I think after. I would like to discuss it.
Let's go our next council meeting. Okay. Yeah. Is that okay?
Let's discuss it. I think we'll have more questions after MCCD. Right. I don't want to put a definite date on it.
And it's not in the land use code, so we don't have to have a public hearing, which makes it a little bit more straightforward as far as just getting it on an agenda versus having to send out public notices.
Okay.
So did you make that?
Yeah. So did I not make that motion?
Do it again.
Okay. I would like to make the motion that we table considering an ordinance amending chapter 2.68 of the Murray City Municipal Code relating to the Murray City Center District Design Review Committee.
I'll second.
Brooke?
Aye.
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 Aye. Mayor?
Thank you. I don't really have anything to report tonight, but I'll take questions if you have any.
How was the pumpkin race?
Pumpkin race got rained on pretty hard.
Oh, no. We should redo it.
But maybe. But the fire department, they stepped in and put up their bucket truck and dropped pumpkin and then dropped the piñata. So the kids, even though they were drenched, they got to go out and get the candy from the piñata. So,
and powered that was a power days that evening. It was a lot more or well attended more than I thought. I was surprised. And I don't know if it's because of online last time or.
It was great.
What. It was a good turnout. Yeah,
it was, huh?
It was really well appreciate attended. You being there.
Yeah. Thanks, Mayor.
Anything else? All right. Seeing no other comments or questions, this meeting is adjourned.